Good evening, boxing fans, and welcome back. Am I the only one who misses the incredible analogies that Larry Merchant used to make during his HBO broadcasts?
Floyd Mayweather is supposed to win. He's a virtuoso in his prime. Only complacency truly can endanger him. But, there's always a but, what if, say, Floyd Mayweather were a blinged out, souped up Porsche, built for speed? And what if Oscar De La Hoya was an Aston Martin with power under the hood? And it turned out they had a collision.
Collision is what everybody most hopes for.
This is Rummy's Corner. Rummy's Corner. So when it comes to the career of Oscar De La Hoya, personally, I think he had a pretty outstanding professional boxing career. But if you listen to fans on boxing message boards these days, you would think that De La Hoya only had six fights, those being the six most controversial fights that he had during his career. And I don't think that tells the whole picture, but for a variety of different reasons, these six fights stand out among all others when it comes to discussing the career of Oscar De La Hoya. So the first of these six bouts in question took place on April 12, 1997, when De La Hoya challenged then WBC welterweight champion Pernell Whitaker. Going into this bout, Whitaker was widely regarded as the best pound-for-pound fighter in the world, and De La Hoya himself had been climbing those ranks in his own right. This was De La Hoya's first fight at welterweight. Whitaker, despite having been at the weight, being a champion in the weight, was quite a few. I think he was 4 or 5 inches shorter than Oscar. So Oscar had a size advantage, despite the fact that he was moving up in weight. He was the naturally bigger guy in there. At the time I first saw this bout, I remember thinking that Sweet Pea deserved the victory, and I thought very strongly about that at the time. So I rewatched this along with the other five bouts that I'm going to talk about in this episode. So I rewatched 72 rounds of boxing, and going through this fight, right from the get-go, it reminded me a lot of what I had in my memories from the first time I watched it. Mainly that Sweet Pea was able to successfully disrupt Oscar's rhythm, he was able to control the pace a little better, and as a result of all this and making Oscar miss a lot, he was able to largely dictate the action. So Sweet Pea was using his veteran poise and his craftiness to try to disrupt and confuse Oscar. Oscar, on the other hand, was trying to impose his size and youth on Whitaker. And what really unfolded over the course of 12 rounds was a judging nightmare. And there were some weird things that happened in this fight. In the third round, there was an accidental headbutt where Oscar De La Hoya suffered a cut, and I didn't remember this, but apparently, at the time, the WBC had some bogus rule where if there was an accidental headbutt and one fighter got cut, the uncut fighter loses a point. And this makes absolutely no sense to me whatsoever. I'm not sure how long Jose Suleiman had implemented that rule for. It couldn't have been very long lasting. Like I said, I'd forgotten that this even happened in that fight. So anyway, in the third round, we have an accidental clash of heads. De La Hoya is cut, and Sweet Pea loses a point. So then in the rest of the fight, it continued to be a difficult fight to score. And I think it was in the sixth round, it was one of the rounds where De La Hoya came out fighting as a southpaw. He had switched to southpaw on a few instances earlier in the fight. And I remember Larry Merchant being unhappy with Oscar's decision to try to switch things up and not do the things that had been working for him. And anyway, the next round, the seventh round, I think there was an incident where Sweet Pea tackled De La Hoya and they went crashing down to the canvas. And then in the ninth round, with under a minute left, Sweet Pea caught Oscar with a nice quick left hand, and Oscar, his knee and his glove touched the ground, so it's technically a knockdown and correctly ruled a knockdown. I remember the commentators on HBO, Lampley in particular, describing it as a soft blow, and while I agree that it wasn't a murderous blow, and it was more of a flash knockdown than anything, I thought it was a pretty crisp, well-timed punch from Whittaker myself, even though the commentators didn't seem to agree. Regardless, Oscar suffered a knockdown, he would lose a point there, and the next three rounds continued to be an absolute scoring nightmare for the judges. Whittaker seemed to be throwing and landing more punches and landing at a higher percentage. Oscar seemed to be landing more, quote, power shots, but as Merchant had noted at some point during this broadcast, even though what De La Hoya was throwing may have technically been counted as power shots by CompuBox, these weren't tremendous, overpowering type punches where, wow, look at all those power punches. It wasn't that type of situation at all. At the end of the day, Oscar De La Hoya was awarded a unanimous decision. Two judges scoring the bout for him 116 to 110, with the other judge scoring it 115 to 111. Watching this fight again, it was a close fight, I think. I know a lot of Oscar's detractors out there scream and cry that this was a robbery. I myself scored the fight 114-112 to Sweet Pea, but this was no robbery any way you slice it. The thing that I kind of took issue with is I thought the margin of victory for Oscar was wide, regardless of what your final tally was. That was a close fight, and to have 116-110 and 115-111, that means you're giving Oscar, two of the judges gave him 9 rounds and another one gave him 8. After rewatching this fight, I'm still not seeing that. I had the score 114-112 for Sweet Pea. And just to give you an idea on how some others scored it, Harold Letterman, the HBO unofficial scorer, while I don't always agree with him, I always respect his scoring, and far more often than not, I think he's on or very close to the mark. He scored the bout 114-112 for Oscar De La Hoya. And to give you another point of reference, well, not as well known as Harold Letterman, intentional but, ESB's longtime round-by-round guru, he also scored the fight 114-112 for Oscar De La Hoya. And like Letterman, I don't always agree with IB's scorecards, but I think he's right far more often than not. So while Letterman and IB might be on opposite sides of the spectrum when it comes to being well known inside the boxing community, the way I see it, they're two guys that scored a lot of fights. They do a pretty damn good job scoring fights. And I happen to think they both have pretty unbiased opinions. So I'm gonna use them as a point of reference going forward here today. The second controversial matchup for Oscar took place on February 13th, 1999, when he took on Ike Corte and Oscar defended his welterweight WBC title. Before the bout, Ike actually had been, I think it was the WBA welterweight champion, but somehow with the politics involved at the time, in order for Corte to secure the bout with De La Hoya, he had to vacate his WBA strap to get the big payday and the opportunity against Oscar De La Hoya. So this was a fight, I remember when I first watched it, I thought that Oscar won the fight based on his very strong finish, which we'll get to in a bit. But this was another fight that was not easy to score, but probably not as difficult to score as the bout between De La Hoya and Whittaker. In fact, I think the first 2 rounds of the fight with Corte kind of act as a microcosm for the fight as a whole. In the first round, Oscar basically won on activity. He was throwing a lot of nice, good, short combinations, and in return, Ike was mostly throwing one jab at a time, and at this point in the opening round, I didn't think Ike's jab was particularly effective. Oscar was deflecting or avoiding most of them. Those that got through, I didn't think were particularly damaging, and again, Oscar took the round based on activity and good combination punching. In the second round, for whatever reason, Oscar took his foot off the gas. And Ike was jabbing, and when De La Hoya wasn't throwing, Ike was jabbing more frequently, finding the timing, finding his range, and he was landing jabs. And unlike the first round where Oscar was deflecting and blocking and dodging and slipping most of them, in this round, Ike's jabs started landing, and they started landing flush, and it was a nice, stiff jab from Ike Corte. And Oscar really just didn't throw much of anything. I think he flurried at the end of that round, but the round was won on Ike's jab, and this basically became the story of the fight. In the rounds where Oscar was throwing punches and being active and putting together some nice short combinations, Oscar was winning. In the rounds where Oscar wasn't throwing many punches and his activity rate was down below the standard where he was having success, then Ike's jab would take over and he would win the rounds. And we had a lot of that going on, but there was enough close rounds in between where it did become another difficult fight to score. So then the sixth round became one of the most explosive rounds in the fight. De La Hoya came out and he dropped Ike hard with a nice left hook. And it looked like all of a sudden everything had shifted Oscar's favor. It was a good knockdown. He came out like a ball of fire that round. And Oscar jumped on him. He was throwing. He was looking to see if he couldn't follow up with another big punch to see what would happen. But Oscar may have punched himself out a little bit there. And then a minute into the round, Ike would land a real sneaky left hand and he would drop Oscar. So all of a sudden, Oscar's momentum was completely derailed. And after Ike dropped Oscar, he would go on to have a very good remaining 2 minutes in that round. And I think with each fighter knocking the other down, Ike definitely controlled the latter 2 minutes of the round. So that wound up becoming an Ike Corte round. The next few rounds, Ike started building a little momentum to overcome the early momentum that De La Hoya had, where he was being more active. In these rounds, he wasn't throwing much of anything. Ike Corte seemed to be getting more confident, and he started landing with greater regularity. So then after scoring the 11th round for Ike, I had Oscar down 3 points going into the final round. And of course, Oscar would come out. He had that great explosive start to the 12th. He would drop Corte again for a second time in the fight. And then he would go after Corte with a ferocious attack. And Corte persevered. He withstood the punishment. There was some great action in the first minute of that round. But then Oscar, again, he kind of punched himself out. So I scored about 7-5, 114-113 in favor of Ike Corte. And the first time I watched a fight, I had De La Hoya winning. And I think the pivotal difference this time around, in my opinion, was that 11th round, where if you'd given Oscar that round, and he had a case for that round, that was one of those tough rounds to score. If you give that to him, then it would be the reverse score, 114-113 for Oscar. In any case, I scored it 114-113 for Ike. The official judges saw it differently. One of the judges scored the bout 115-114 to Ike, but they were overruled by the other two judges that scored it 116-113 and 116-112, both in favor of Oscar De La Hoya. So De La Hoya was the victor by split decision. How did Letterman have it? Letterman agreed with me on this one. He had Ike winning the bout 114-113. How about ESB's round-by-round guru, IB? He also agreed with me and Letterman. He had the bout 114-113 in favor of Ike. But again, at the end of the day, this was another extremely close fight that wasn't necessarily easy to score. So all of the Oscar detractors out there crying robbery, I don't think they have a case here. Again, I thought Ike won this fight by 1 point. But certainly there were enough close rounds that you could switch one or two here or there, and I had no problem with Oscar winning, even though I personally had Ike ahead. So the third bout that frequently comes up with Oscar's history of being involved in close bouts that were considered by some to be controversial, that one came on September 18th, 1999, in which is perhaps the most famous of his controversial fights that he was involved in, and that one, of course, was against Felix Tito Trinidad. This was a unification bout between two undefeated welterweight champions. Oscar's WBC title was on the line. Trinidad's IBF title was on the line. It was a big welterweight showdown with lots of hype and all types of comparisons to Leonard Hearn's one, and it was being highly touted in terms of its historical significance. And then you had the Mexican-Puerto Rican rivalry undertone, and you had a big, high-profile mega bout. So I remember originally watching this fight between De La Hoya and Trinidad, and my initial thoughts after the fight was that there was no doubt, none whatsoever, that Oscar De La Hoya won the fight and that he deserved to win the fight. And I thought he did so comfortably. So I was really eager to rewatch this one because I don't know if I saw this one since probably the week after it originally had aired. In any case, a lot of the early rounds went a lot like I had remembered. Oscar was doing more. He was on his toes, he was using movement, he was controlling the action with his jab, and his quicker feet, his quicker hands, his good feints. He had Trinidad a little off balance, a little befuddled, and Trinidad was having trouble keeping up with what Oscar was doing, because Oscar was doing a lot of good stuff in those early rounds. He was boxing very well, and Trinidad seemed a little too slow and too clumsy at that point to really capitalize on much of anything. Oscar had the right idea through three. In the fourth round, Oscar was still jabbing well, he was still moving well, but Trinidad started landing some pretty good shots. They were isolated shots, usually one shot at a time, but Trinidad started putting his punches together a little bit better in this round. And that mostly happened when Oscar was getting a little bit lazy and dropping his left a little bit. Oscar was still doing well, but this was a round I thought that Trinidad won, his first round that he won in the fight. And then the fifth round was another close round where Trinidad sort of carried a little bit of that momentum over, but he didn't really capitalize on it. Oscar started doing a little bit more. It was a very close round. This time around when I watched it, I gave it to Oscar. I'll note that Harold Letterman gave this round to Trinidad, but I thought Oscar did well that round. And then the next couple of rounds, Oscar started doing more of what was working for him early. He was able to turn Trinidad. He was able to move Trinidad. Oscar was using his feet and his quickness to dictate the range. He was controlling the distance. He was fighting at a pace and a distance where he was comfortable, and Trinidad was really having trouble catching up with him on a consistent basis, frequently enough to make more of a fight of it. So through eight rounds, I thought Oscar had won seven rounds, which would mean that Trinidad would either need a knockdown or some situation where he had better than 10-9 rounds the rest of the way through. And I honestly think Oscar did win seven out of the first eight rounds. Although I think there is a case like Letterman had of giving Tito maybe two of those first eight rounds. In any case, the way you listen to people on boxing forums these days, it was at that point that Oscar decided to get on his bicycle and run for the rest of the fight, not throwing a thing while Trinidad stalked him. And that's the common narrative you see on the boxing message boards these days. And Trinidad did do better those final few rounds. Especially in the ninth round, there was a moment where it just occurred to me that Trinidad had stolen the momentum in that fight. And I think the type of fight he was fighting that led him to so much success through seven of the first eight rounds, I think that doing all of that tired him out a good deal, and that his energy was sapping, and Trinidad really hadn't seemed to tire at all. He hadn't been too effective to that point, but he started getting a hell of a lot more effective in the ninth round. The tenth round was a little closer, however. I still think Tito did more. He was landing the better shots, he was landing the harder shots, but Oscar did get a little bit of stuff going there in the tenth, and I think that's part of the thing that gets erased in the revisionism, is that Oscar was still putting up a bit of a fight here. Not a great fight. His strategy is one that has often been criticized ever since this fight, but he was still doing a little something as late as the 10th round. The 11th round was a Trinidad round. The 12th round, Oscar was exhausted. He was moving, but he was really exhausted. At the end of the day, I scored the bout 115 to 113 for Oscar De La Hoya, largely based on the strength of what he did in the first eight rounds. Now, Trinidad did take over and steal the momentum over the last four rounds or so. Oscar did take his foot off the gas and go into a almost purely survival mode. But no matter which way you slice it, if you're scoring this fight on a round-by-round basis, I have a hard time seeing the official scores that came through that favored Trinidad. It was a majority decision for Trinidad, where one judge had it 114-114, and then he was overruled by the two that scored it 115-114 and 115-113, both in favor of Felix Trinidad. I just have a hard time seeing where you get seven rounds for Felix. Even if you gave him that round that Letterman gave him earlier, and that was the only difference in the scorecard that between me and Letterman, even there, Letterman had it a draw, 114-114. I disagreed with him again on that fifth round, I think it was. As for the round-by-round guru, IB had it 115-113 for Oscar. But looking back on this fight now, it was a little bit different than I remembered it, and I think that's largely due to the fact that you read a certain narrative so many times, it kind of sticks, and I hadn't seen the fight in a long while myself. So watching it, it wasn't as if Oscar was dominating quite as well as some people would say, but it also wasn't as if he was just in full retreat mode quite the way people were saying. At the end of the day, a lot of people think this fight was a robbery. I had Oscar winning the first time I watched it. I had Oscar winning reviewing the fight here just recently. I think Oscar deserved to win, but if a guy like Letterman had it a draw, I guess there is another round in there that you could give to Trinidad, so it's not the most outlandish thing. I think one of the outlandish things in this fight was the way the allocation of how the judges gave certain rounds, where it was so bad they started giving De La Hoya rounds at the end on one judge card. I forget the exact details of it. And anyway, we have another example here of Oscar De La Hoya fighting at the highest level in another very close and competitive fight. The next in our series of controversial fights involving Oscar De La Hoya took place on September 13th, 2003. This was a rematch against Sugar Shane Mosley. De La Hoya had lost to Mosley 3 years earlier in a pretty decisive but close contest. This was, I think, Shane's second fight at 154. He was coming off a no contest against Rafael Marquez, I think. And the year before that, he had lost at welterweight two consecutive bouts against Vernon Forrest. So Mosley hadn't won a fight. It was well over a year at this point. So he goes into the De La Hoya fight without any momentum. De La Hoya had kind of revived and built himself a little bit of momentum after losing to Shane. So there was a lot of interest in this fight, especially since their first fight was so entertaining, with the two of them throwing all kinds of nice combinations at one another. And this was a fight that I always had trouble scoring. The first time I watched it live, I scored it for Oscar. I watched it a week later, I scored it for Mosley. I watched it sometime after that, I scored it a draw. So it was a fight that I haven't watched in a bunch of years now, but I had scored it three different ways within the span of 3 weeks, which just indicates to me I thought it was a close fight. Watching the fight again and the difference between their first fight, Oscar came out with more of a tactical approach. He was working behind the jab, and he was trying to do some of the things that made Vernon Forrest successful against Shane a year or two earlier, when Forrest twice beat Shane. The jab was one of the key weapons that Forrest used to neutralize Shane's combinations. And at this point in Shane's career, he had kind of gotten away from combination punching after that first Forrest fight. So Oscar did a good job early on. He was boxing Shane, he was moving well, he was controlling the action and dictating the range through use of his jab. And Mosley wasn't doing much, and Mosley, when he was trying to punch, was just punching one punch at a time. It wasn't the Sugar Shane that we had grown to know prior to the Forrest fight. It was as if a different man had gone into that Shane's body and replaced him forever thereafter. So then there was a lot of rounds where neither guy was really doing a whole lot. But even when they weren't doing a whole lot, Oscar was usually firing the jab with enough frequency that he was still controlling the action and winning points and winning rounds. Shane may have stolen a round or two along the way in the early going, but it wasn't until the eighth round that Shane really started turning things around a little bit. And then in the ninth round was when Shane had his best round in the fight. And this was around the time in the fight where Oscar typically tires a little bit. Shane managed to hit Oscar with some really good shots in that round. I think he had Oscar buzzed or maybe even a little hurt a couple of times throughout that round. The ninth round was a really good round for Shane. And while Shane sort of started picking up a little bit of momentum, the rounds were difficult to score. Shane was definitely doing better over the last part of the fight, but Oscar was still doing a little something here and there, even though I think Shane was winning most of those later rounds. At the end of the day, I scored the bout this time after being so indecisive the first few times I watched it. I'm reverting back to the score I scored it when I originally watched it live on TV. And this time I saw the bout as 115 to 113, 7-5 for Oscar De La Hoya. HBO's unofficial scorer Harold Letterman had it the same way, 115 to 113 for Oscar De La Hoya. ESB's round-by-round guru IB had it the same way, 115 to 113 for Oscar De La Hoya. And then the three official judges all had it the exact opposite. They all had it 115 to 113 for Sugar Shane Mosley. The HBO commentators couldn't believe their ears. Shane Mosley himself looked a little surprised when the decision was announced. With regards to the HBO commentators, they seemed to think Oscar had packed in enough early rounds that he basically had it in the bag, short of a Shane Mosley knockout or at least a knockdown. They were surprised. 115, 113, a lot of people were claiming robbery, people were saying all this, and Oscar was claiming he was gonna unleash some kind of investigation. I think this is just another example of Oscar being involved in a close fight against an upper echelon opponent. I mean, we're seeing a pattern here. And when Oscar is active, he usually wins these close fights or the rounds in these close fights. When he's less active, he tends to lose these type of rounds. But we're seeing Oscar involved in fights that are close, whose conclusions are always going to be debatable. The next fight I'd like to discuss happened on June 5th, 2004. And that's when Oscar De La Hoya moved up in weight to challenge Felix Sturm for his WBO middleweight title. This was at a time when De La Hoya and Hopkins were kind of courting their way towards a matchup, and they were co-featured on this card. I think Hopkins had his third fight with Robert Allen on the same pay-per-view event. Anyway, the plan was for Oscar to win Sturm's WBO title and then challenge Hopkins, who held the WBC, the WBA, and the IBF versions of the titles. The idea was to have the four of them meet in a one-of-a-kind, something I believe that had never happened before, a true unification bout between what now is recognized as four official sanctioning bodies. So Oscar fights Felix Sturm, and he comes out in the first round, and it was very bizarre because it's his first fight at 160. I didn't think Oscar looked particularly good at the weight. I thought he looked a little soft, and I think that it was a little bit of an indication that maybe he had gone up a weight class too much. But he comes out in the first round and he's throwing fire like I've never seen. And Oscar's just firing off punches, he's firing off combinations, he's going right at the champion, and Sturm is here under fire. Oscar seems to be quicker, faster, he's getting hit with punches, Oscar's throwing a lot of punches, and I think by the end of the round, I believe the commentator said that Oscar threw something like 103 punches, and I think it was the most or the second most punches he ever threw in a round before, and this was in his very first round at middleweight. And this was something that Roy Jones himself had commented on, and Bernard Hopkins, who they went to during in between rounds at some point during the fight, asking him, he was also surprised at Oscar's strategy. And this was a strategy that Oscar would continue to use. He was being a far more active than normal Oscar De La Hoya, throwing a lot of punches, trying to gain Sturm's respect, but in the process, eating some very accurate, very hard jabs from Sturm that seemed to rock Oscar to his very foundation. every time he ate a flush jab. Oscar's in there, throwing a lot of punches. He's a guy who's known to tire late in big fights. We've gone over a couple of them here, including the Trinidad fight. So Oscar's employing this strategy, and he's doing well in the early rounds. Sturm's having his moments. I think Sturm won at least one of the first six rounds by landing the more accurate blows. But Oscar's activity was seeing the day, and it was bizarre because Oscar showed he had the speed and the movement that he could hit Sturm. It just seemed like he was playing with fire with his whole approach. So as the fight went on, predictably, Oscar started getting tired and slowing down. The investment he had made, because he did throw a hell of a lot of good body shots in this fight, and that investment he made into the body, it didn't seem to slow Sturm down, and Sturm was like Steady Eddie in this fight. He was consistently doing the same things, taking a very tactical approach, very efficient with his punch selection, landing straight lefts, landing right hands, occasionally throwing some short combinations together of his own. And his methodical approach started paying off when Oscar tired. So after Oscar banked a lot of the earlier rounds, Sturm started taking over and was decisively winning a lot of the later rounds. At the end of the fight, the HBO commentators, they always seem to get it wrong when it comes to Oscar in a big fight. The HBO commentators thought that Oscar had surely lost and that the whole plans for Hopkins De La Hoya were completely derailed. But little did they know, the official judges would award the fight for Oscar De La Hoya, with all three judges scoring the bout 115 to 113 in favor of the Golden Boy. I thought Sturm won the first time I watched the fight, and scoring it here again recently, I scored the bout 115 to 113 for Felix Sturm. I really thought he deserved to win this fight. It was a close fight. And again, a pattern forming here. Oscar De La Hoya involved in a close and competitive fight at the highest level. Close and competitive, I scored at 115-113 to Sturm. HBO's unofficial scorer, Harold Letterman, he also had it 115-113 for Sturm. And then IB, ESB's round-by-round guru, he had it 115-113 for Felix Sturm. So this was another one of those fights where Letterman, IB, and me were all in agreement. It would have been a unanimous decision had we been the three official judges for a favor of Sturm, but we were not the official judges. And the official judges saw it Oscar's way. And you almost got the impression that there was nothing that was going to derail the mega event that would unfold between De La Hoya and Hopkins. But to me, that fight lost a ton of its luster. Officially getting the win or not, I just didn't think Oscar looked well suited for middleweight. And if he looked that bad against Felix Sturm, I don't really see how anybody thought he could reasonably have beaten a real, true, great fighter in Bernard Hopkins. Was this one a robbery? I'm not gonna say that it was. But I really think the majority of people outside of those three judges thought that Felix Sturm deserved the victory. And if you listen to De La Hoya himself, even though he was victorious, and I got the clip here, he doesn't sound like a man who's very happy, and he doesn't sound like a man who had just won a version of the middleweight title going into a super bout against Bernard Hopkins.
Congratulations, Oscar, but you don't look very elated about this.
Everything went wrong tonight. Everything. Everything went out. I mean, what can I do? What can I say?
What do you mean by everything?
I trained as hard as I can. We did everything perfect, sparring with big guys. But I stepped in the ring and boom, nothing.
So the last fight I'm going to talk about here happened on May 5th. 2007, when the Golden Boy defended his WBC 154-pound title against Floyd Mayweather Jr. I'm including this fight because there's a large faction of people out there who seem to deem this was a controversial fight and that Oscar either did enough to win or deserve a draw. I never thought that. I always thought this was a comfortable win for Floyd. I think those that claim Oscar won are either really, really big De La Hoya fans, really, really big haters of Floyd Mayweather, or a combination of both, but I decided to give the fight another watch. I hadn't watched it since, I guess, a week after it happened. Gave it another look to see if maybe there wasn't more there than I thought. I originally thought Floyd had won handily, clearly. So watching it again, the only thing that surprised me, I knew Oscar was doing well early in the fight. I remember that from watching it originally. But he actually fought much, much better than I had remembered. And it was a really strong effort from De La Hoya on that night where I really think he gave it everything he had and had the best preparation he could have had for that fight. You know, the common narrative on this one now is that Oscar came out, he was winning through six, throwing a lot of jabs. Then he stopped jabbing around the second half of the fight and that was it. Floyd took over because Oscar stopped jabbing. But it was interesting because in the first round, Oscar really wasn't jabbing at all. And I didn't remember it that way. I thought the common narrative, he came out jabbing. Watching it again, I realized he really wasn't doing much jabbing in the opening round. It was a slow feeler out type of round. Floyd was the more accurate puncher. He was the sharper puncher. He was more efficient, more intelligent inside the ring. But Oscar really wasn't jabbing. That changed in round two, where Oscar did come out firing jabs. Oscar was landing jabs, and behind the jabs, he was able to pin Mayweather on the ropes a couple of times where he was throwing a lot of shots. A lot of them were being deflected and weren't landing, but Oscar was throwing. He had an activity rate going on, and some of them actually were landing, even if they were partially blocked or partially slipped. So Oscar started doing well, and he threw a lot of jabs in that second round, and it was a good round for him. I thought the third round was a close round where De La Hoya wasn't jabbing quite as much and Floyd was just being Floyd. So I thought Floyd won the third round, and then in the fourth round it was a really good round for De La Hoya. He came in and he unleashed a nice body assault and he landed some big punches throughout that round. He wasn't really setting a lot of them up with the jab either. He was just aggressive, finding the mark, timing his shots well, and he was imposing his size on Floyd. And he had a lot of success, I thought, in that round. I know in that one stretch of body punches, it may not have been the most effective thing, but at the same time, Oscar was in there, and I think he had the right idea, and even if they weren't hurting blows, as Merchant said, they couldn't have been doing him any good, and Oscar was scoring while Floyd wasn't, so it was a good round for Oscar. I thought Floyd turned things around in the fifth round and was more active and more effective. It was a really good round for Floyd. But then the sixth round, it was an excellent round for Oscar, but again, he wasn't jabbing nearly as much as I had remembered, except at round two to this point. At this round, he actually put some defensive wizardry of his own on display, showing Floyd that he wasn't the only one that can duck and dodge. He had some good defense this round, Oscar, and he landed several decent shots throughout the round. And then in the seventh round, again, it was a very good round for De La Hoya. He came out jabbing, he was landing some big shots early, and he had a few good flurries in this round. This was the best round, the seventh round, in terms of Oscar jabbing since the second. And this is what surprised me. I remembered Oscar, in my own mind, I thought he was jabbing more consistently through these early rounds, through the first seven rounds. But he really wasn't. There was only two rounds I thought he was using the jab especially well. But yet, after seven rounds, I thought Oscar De La Hoya was winning the fight. I thought he was winning the fight 4-3. And then Floyd kind of stole all the momentum back. De La Hoya would have moments. Sometimes he'd be jabbing early. Sometimes he'd end rounds with little flurries. But Floyd really started landing some very accurate flush shots in round eight. In the ninth round, De La Hoya was trying to attack here and there, but it was another very good round for Floyd Mayweather. Oscar was mostly ineffective at this point. Floyd was more active and far more accurate. So I think Mayweather was kind of cruising at this point through these next few rounds leading into the championship rounds. And even into the championship rounds, I thought Mayweather was doing more. De La Hoya wasn't doing much, and this is the point of the fight where Floyd became Floyd Mayweather, started doing what he does best, and he started dissecting a tired, but still game De La Hoya, because it wasn't as if De La Hoya turned the switch off entirely. He was still trying to win this fight. So that last round was much closer than I had remembered it. I think you could have had that round go either way, depending on your personal preference. Regardless, I don't think it made a difference in the final outcome, because I think at that point, Floyd Mayweather Jr. had already had the fight in the bag. I scored the bout 116 to 112, 8-4 in favor of Floyd Mayweather Jr. As a point of comparison, HBO's unofficial scorer Harold Letterman had the bout 116 to 112 also for Floyd Mayweather Jr. And ESB's round-by-round guru Intentional Butt likewise had it 116 to 112 for Floyd Mayweather Jr., with the trio of unofficial scorers once again in agreement. The official judges, on the other hand, one of them had it 116-112 for Floyd Mayweather, another had it 115-113 for Floyd Mayweather, and then one dissenting judge scored it in Oscar's favor, 115-113. I'm really hard-pressed to see how one gets it a draw for Oscar, let alone 7-5 in Oscar's favor. I am just not seeing that. Nonetheless, Floyd Mayweather Jr. was awarded a split decision victory against Oscar De La Hoya. And even though I thought this one was a clear win for Floyd, Oscar once again found himself in a very competitive matchup. So at the end of the day, I really think that these six fights are going to be what largely defines Oscar De La Hoya's legacy for the foreseeable future. These just seem to be the six fights that come up most often in conversation. You don't hear people talking about his decisive victories as often. It just doesn't happen. It's these six bouts. But what I think of Oscar from my worthless two cents is he's a guy who fought almost everyone in his era. Yeah, he missed a few names along the way. And personally, I think he would have lost to guys like Vernon Forrest and Winky Wright. But on the other hand, I think he would have beaten guys like Miguel Cotto and Antonio Margarito and Ricky Hatton and the likes. So, he missed a few names, but he fought a lot of awesome fighters during his career. And for that, I think Oscar De La Hoya needs to be applauded. I mean, think about it for a minute. This guy faced Pernell Whitaker when he was at or near the top of all pound-for-pound lists. He fought Felix Trinidad when he was at or near the top of everyone's pound-for-pound list. He fought Sugar Shane Mosley when he was at or near the top of everybody's pound-for-pound list. He fought Bernard Hopkins at a time when he was at or very near the top of everyone's pound-for-pound list. And he even fought Floyd Mayweather Jr. and Manny Pacquiao when they were each respectively considered the absolute pound-for-pound king in the sport. How anybody can look at that career and be critical, I don't see it. There's plenty there to admire in what Oscar did. He may not have been the best, but he fought most of the fights that mattered most when they mattered. And for that, I applaud him. This is Rumsfeld. Thank you for tuning in. If you enjoyed this episode, please do subscribe to my channel. Thank you and good night.